Hello, hello, and thank you so much for coming to today's seminar. I am Jennifer Bagley, the CEO of CI Web Group, and today, again, I am so lucky. I think we're 3 weeks in a row being able to be blessed with our senior developer and IT director, Mr. Cruzini. Of course, we're getting bows right now. Everybody should be applauding. Mr. President William Preston, let him out of his cave. Doesn't happen very often. All right. Today, we are going to be talking about how to build a website. We've done a last few of the sessions that we have covered have really been about security. We probably scared the bejesus out of you, but so be it. It's necessary because security is a really, really big deal as it pertains to building the website. The first thing I want to talk about is layers. Websites are built in layers, right? Now, I shouldn't even say that, right? Because 99% of the websites on the Internet, and that's a fictitious number. I got it from nowhere, but it's easy for me to say and it sounds good. The majority of websites that are on the Internet, because there's trillions of websites, are shag carpets, for lack of a better term.
Which is why it's easy if you have a CMS to jump up, you know, up to the top 50% easy.
Absolutely, because the bottom tier, the bottom 60, 70, 80% of websites on the Internet are all shag carpets. They were all built by one of my triple F friends.
Family.
And fools.
Fools.
Okay. Except my family. All right. Now, I know you guys have heard of Dreamweaver, Frontpage. These are beautiful blondes with no brain. They don't have a brain. They don't have any insides. They don't have any guts. They don't think. They are, oh, yes, I have Adobe Dreamweaver on my computer. So these are painting pretty pictures. So, yes, it's painting pretty pictures. So most people, when we hire our nephews, cousins, and so forth to build websites for us, we have templates.net, very interesting, and they build these little websites that are built in tables. Okay, so Alt-Tab over to, actually, I met with one of our clients who's getting a new website with us, and I know Mr. Spencer Price is not going to mind us going over his website, but go over to very center tab, one more over to the right. Okay, so one of our clients with Watermax, by the way, Watermax, hot, hot, hot. This is going to be a big, big, big company.
I bought stock.
Yeah. This is one of the rare occasions when I'm willing to trade. So, big company. Spencer is went to school for marketing, has his marketing degree. Let's right click and let's go look at the tables. His website was built in tables. Unfortunately, Google used to allow tables for website building, which the majority of people who are using, not all, but the majority of people who are using DreamWorks and what's the other one?
Frontpage.
They build websites in tables. They build websites without brains, without content management systems. It would be literally like having the body of a car that has no engine, nowhere to sit, and actually nowhere to drive. Is that a good analogy?
That is awesome. Yeah,
absolutely. Okay. So you bought a shell, and we're just anything you want to know. I love it because you can go to Google. So Chris just went to Google and typed in why not to use tables.
There's 101 reasons.
Just don't do it. Okay? Just don't do it. If you have a website that was built 5 years ago, 7 years ago, 10 years ago, I want you to think about technology. Actually, let me throw out some fictitious, but I'll be as close to accurate as possible numbers. Television took like 40 years to reach 150 million people. Radio took like 39 years to reach 150 million people. MySpace took 12 years to reach, and I'm really, really close. I might not be 100% on, but took, and I have this. I have the actual numbers in a different presentation. Facebook took 2 years. That's the number that I'll be out there, and that's the right number. Took 2 years to hit 150 million people. Technology today is changing so fast. exponentially. We cannot wait like we have been able to with in different times when technology wasn't moving at the same rate that it is now, but we can't wait like we used to. You agree?
Absolutely. It's just going way too fast. I mean, even college courses are outdated before they hit the press. The only college courses that are, you know, renowned, especially for computer science, are, you know, ones that are doing 100% of their stuff off the web.
So, you know what? I am always asked to speak at the UNT Technology Conference. Actually, I'm speaking there next week at the University of North Texas Technology Conference in Denton. And I always get into these conversations with the computer science teachers. I find myself wanting to strangle them because I shouldn't say that. I go there every year.
Yeah.
But I learn what they're teaching the kids, and they're teaching the kids how to design websites for 10 years ago, today.
It's absolutely insane. Actually, you know, Grantham University of Missouri was one of the things I was kind of forced to attend when I was in Iraq. You know, no offense to the faculty, they were great. However, they were still teaching table designs when your image is over on the left and you want your content over the right. You know, the best thing to do is create a table. I'm like, that is seriously only applicable for like 4 or 5 years ago. However, the text and the materials haven't been up to date.
So everybody that says, well, my son just went to school and got his degree for web design.
Then they hit real world.
Run. I don't know what to tell you.
Yeah.
Run. I mean, when we're looking at programmers to hire, I get nervous when they say, I'm going to school for web design. I'm like, yeah.
Please stop.
I'm like, no, come in and tell me that you've been hacking since you were 12 and you made your first $100 online by the time you were 13, right? That's who I want to...
I thought you were just going
to... So, real programmers, developers, this is what they do. So you have to be really, really careful because your actual formal courses for web design today, and of course everything I tell you, because this is recording, is dated. So you could be listening to this 1 year from now, 2 years from now, 3 years from now, and we could have new textbooks, and we could actually have some really smart instructors in schools, and I might be way off base. So take it into context. However, today, everything that I've seen...
I could win the lotto.
Yes, I could win the lotto. Everything that I've seen is, unfortunately, this is what we're getting, and these sites don't perform. So let's go over to Website Grader. Now, I use Website Grader a lot. My programmers laugh because... it's a joke compared to the actual tools that we use as a company to be able to evaluate websites are much, much more complex than Website Grader. They're not free, right.
They're not publicly accessible either.
They're not public, and the average person's not going to understand them. And we don't have an interest in sitting down with a client and totally confusing them by looking at very, very complicated analytics on a website.
That's not very beneficial. And actually, there's a lot of people, companies out there that will do that. I call it the confusion factor. They get them in with the intent of confusing them until they're ready to buy.
Yeah, so not going to happen in this space. So Website Grader is a very great tool. It's an aggregator of information that is going to put it into an easy format for you to be able to kind of get an idea. So is the site going to grade high? No. 21 out of 100. Luckily in this situation, actually the content can be read. So we have 12 index pages, no blog, so it's not a dynamic site. Normally in this situation, you'll see readability level and it'll say not enough content to be able to evaluate. We'll go down to the optimize area. So another way to tell that you have an old website is if you have no heading. Because headings are relatively new, H1 tags, H2 tags, and so forth, kind of, sort of, yes?
They're new in the way that they're evaluated now by Google. They've been around since, like, technically, the headings have been around since, like, 2001.
But they're weighted higher now,
but,
right?
But, yeah, now they're important.
Okay. Because in, when would you say, 91?
Yeah.
In 91, we're looking at a few million websites, right?
If you're lucky, yeah.
Maybe,
yeah.
Maybe not. So back then it wasn't as important for Google to be able to determine how relevant the content was to be able to serve it up to the end consumer who was looking. But
yeah.
Now there's trillions, and Google has milliseconds to be able to identify, read through 2.5 million different web pages and be able to serve up the right content. So it would kind of be like reading through 2.5 million newspapers with no headings, with
right.
no titles.
Right, and those actually, believe it or not, are just chucked away now. The MapReduce algorithms that are being used, and I've been meaning to talk to you about this, Chase was working on it. MapReduce algorithms are basically algorithms that compare, reduce, and anything that shows up on the top 10 pages are basically, there you go, patent software source introduced by Google for distributing large data sets. So basically, if you don't have any headings, you're just screwed.
You're invisible. No headings, no go. But that's also a really quick way to indicate that you have a very old website or someone very old. I shouldn't have said that. Okay, so that's no headings, right? Maybe you don't look bad. Okay, let's skip. We're done here. Okay, we don't need to go on here. We don't need to spend too much time here. If you have a website that's been built in Dreamweaver or a front page, you're basically dating a very empty blonde with no brain, even if it's gorgeous. Obviously, that's the same thing as what you're going to deal with Flash as well. All right, so let's go to how a website really should be built. So our company, we have actually taken WordPress because it is the largest framework that exists, the most powerful content management system known today, faster growth, faster network of developers, faster adoption of within the community, faster corporate adoption as well. Microsoft has replaced all of their blogs, right?
Yep. Yep. Microsoft's using it now. I mean, all the big players are using it now. What was the open source report that we read that showed the training? It's blowing everything out of the water, hands down. I mean, just like I predicted it was 5 years ago.
So he did too. Trust me, because I remember the conference call when he mandated we all get on the phone and go over this. All right, but let me put things into perspective. WordPress is a methodology. It is not a website. Okay, WordPress is built of different layers, the first layer being the database, which is the repository. WordPress utilizes the largest open source database platform in the world today, MySQL.
Yep.
MySQL.
Or MySQL, depending on where you're from.
Yes.
What kind of corporate
English accent. MySQL. All right. So explain MySQL.
MySQL is a relational database application. It actually just recently got bought out. However, there's nothing that looks like it's going to be changing anytime soon. Some microsystems have got that. But the reason why they did is because, you know, which their marketing department defined as being the smartest decision is gearing towards open source distribution. So.
Yeah.
It was really good. If you guys don't know, you know their counterpart is Oracle, which is the commercial based supported, which was slowly.
That's like the Microsoft version.
Yeah, which
commercial based.
Yeah, which Oracle is awesome. Oracle is absolutely awesome. You get a little bit more flexibility with your queries, a little bit more efficient, which is surprising, because usually open source is, you know, open source anything is so much better. However, it's still, you know, because it doesn't
not
have
free.
It's not free, and there are things that are really, really, really close, you know, to that same level of powerhouse as Oracle, you know, of course it's going to gain market share, you know, in that environment.
Okay, so MySQL in a nutshell is a whole bunch of very strong databases, right? Like Excel spreadsheets. Tons of tables.
Right.
Every table.
This is one database right here.
So one website has one database. It can have multiple
databases. Technically, it can. I mean, yeah, if it's using
multiple applications. Yeah, but we have, this is what we build for the clients. So we have dozens and dozens of tables. Every table has multiple columns, so we can keep clicking through here.
Let me
you can have someone that knows how to build a MySQL database. Got it. There's people who can work Microsoft Excel as well. However, there is object-oriented database structure, and non-object-oriented database structure. This is when you're going to see my nerd come out, right?
Yeah.
I'm not the sales. I'm a nerd. So all programmers not created equally. Just because you can learn to create a database in MySQL does not mean that it's created properly. And when I say properly, it's got to be built for scalability. Got to be built to be able to continue and scale, which is why object-oriented database programming is so critical. Yes?
Absolutely. Object-oriented is what took PHP off and why WordPress was developed in PHP and all these other applications that are coming out, and the frameworks becoming more robust within framework, and even people using stuff like Cake PHP. But the whole level of the methodology of object-oriented just makes it completely expandable. It's what makes it able to compete at the enterprise level with J2EE.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So
Java.
Yes. So what Chris is looking at now you're in Vim, which you're a bigger nerd than most nerds.
Yeah.
Right? So it actually probably kills him to actually see a screen that has more white than black.
Yeah. This is a text-based interface of the database where I'm actually looking at the database through the MySQL client.
So for a random, because we're talking to website owners, right?
Right.
We're confusing them.
Sorry.
No,
sorry, guys.
I'm with you. However, so for a typical website owner, if they're talking to a programmer and they want to know what their experience level is with programming, is a good question. How do you program? Do you program directly in the MySQL database, or do you program in Vim or PuTTY?
That's only asking a user's IDE.
What is IDE?
IDE is, it's just going to go straight to that. Go Wikipedia, IDE. IDE is an integrated development environment. Computers, here we go. It is what you use to be able to map out your project from beginning to end, what database tables it's going to use, what the actual code editing portion of it, and, some lightweight IDEs only contain a code editing portion of it. But basically it is what do they use, what tool sets do they use to be able to get done what they get done.
What answers are you looking for? So if you say what, and even tool sets, what applications do you use to develop in? Is that okay?
Well, let's take Stanley tools sold by Walmart and Craftsman tools sold by people like Snap-on. If somebody's using Front Page or something similar to that, they are basically chintzing your stuff together with plastic hammers.
Tape,
right. It is usually... Yeah, usually people use these kind of editors, even Dreamweaver. They use editors like this because they don't understand or they need the assistance of the, $1,000 software to be able to even produce anything at all.
Okay, so now let's go into WYSIWYG, right? Type in WYSIWYG because I want them to see that. WYSIWYG is a real word, by the way. WYSIWYG editors. WordPress is a WYSIWYG editor. So, but we use it. Our company, we use at least 20% of the WordPress framework because we're smart. Oh, that was just a good, flat answer. Because we know we are able to develop. Because we know we're able to develop on the backs of tens of thousands of other developers' work. Because we're able to... We are experts in MySQL, which is the database framework we just looked at. We are experts in the primary language that WordPress was built in. And how long do you think? It probably took you a couple years to become a major, major expert at the WordPress hooks, accents, and filters framework.
Yeah, and the challenge with that is it's actually, I think, Adam Brown took database. Adam Brown took database. This guy shows the amount of hooks that are added to WordPress on a graph. Now, as each version comes out of WordPress, they continue to add a ridiculous number of hooks.
What's a hook?
A hook is something you can hook into. For example, I just clicked publish. And this is before Save to the Database. And then there's the after Save the Database hook. Then there is the before print the post on the screen hook. There's the before I printed the footer on the bottom of the page hook.
There's the save draft without me thinking about it.
Yes, right, the autosave. You know, yes. there are all of these hooks that are listed. And this is your learning curve. This is your learning curve on a scale. Just between WordPress 3.0 and 3.1, you're seeing a 200 hook increase. So you are seeing what you have to learn and keep up with is absolutely insane. But the reason is because they are catering to the needs of the public. People are saying, I need to be able to change this before this happens. I need to be able to do this before this. Or I want to be able to integrate Ajax and do things without the page reloading so that my website looks like an application.
Okay, we have another new question. So write this down. If you're talking, that's you, Hope. If you're talking to a WordPress, quote unquote, expert, designer, developer, theme creator, theme installer, most of them are. If you're talking to them, one of the questions you're going to want to ask them is, are they familiar with and do they use the WordPress hooks, actions, and filters framework? And how do they stay current? If they stare at you like they have no clue what you're talking about, which 90% of them, and again, another fictitious number, I should say 99.
By my ratio, 100%. Everybody's
100%. I know, I agree. I've never met anybody that, well, I can't say that because we deal with WordPress directly. But the majority of people who are WordPress designers, WordPress coders, WordPress developers, and so forth, never learned the language, the framework, the taxonomies,
yes.
Right? See, I'm smart.
Of
WordPress, they simply learned how to install WordPress and how to install a theme and how to use the WYSIWYG editor in order to make changes to tables and footers and post data and so forth, correct?
Absolutely.
Header data.
They learned the bare minimum necessary to jump into a pre-built theme and modify.
And tell you they build websites.
Yes.
So that's another question. Ask them, do you use hooks, actions, and filters, and how do you keep up? How many new hooks have been added since the last version? And if you're not hearing 200, then you're probably dealing with someone that doesn't understand how WordPress actually works, which means as your business grows, as it develops, they're not going to be able to scale it with you. Not even including the basics as in, they probably don't have the knowledge it takes to be able to ensure that your site is properly maintained, that you are not utilizing any corrupt or, bad, I'm just going to say bad.
Malformed.
Yeah, malware-based plugins and so forth.
Oh, yeah.
But the biggest thing is, outside of complete security and you going to jail, is it's not scalable. They don't know how to build on it. So what are some of the biggest things about WordPress as far as from a developer standpoint?
Oh, my gosh. The things change all the time. WordPress is as bleeding edge as it gets. And part of the challenge of that is because Automattic is such a great company. Matt is absolutely awesome, great guy. They always keep their stuff so up to date. Now, the challenge is everybody that builds plugins, whoever built your favorite image gallery plugin or whatever else, doesn't always stay up to date. So you're caught a lot of times in a catch-22 where you are either going to update your core and upgrade the security of your website because now it's been publicized that there's an exploit, or you choose not to keep your plugin. Because the plugin, you know, it hasn't been updated in the last 8 months.
Compatibility. So we have another question to ask. Write this down. Here's another question, not you. We have another question to ask. If you're dealing with a WordPress designer, developer, / theme installer, ask them, do you build your own custom plugins? Are you a plugin developer and do you build plugins custom? Or do you install free plugins, yes?
Yeah, what do you know about the plugin API? The plugin API is, and this goes hand in hand with hooks, actions, and filters, WordPress plugin. The plugin API is basically where everybody starts learning. It tells you what they are and everything else. So if they keep up to date with plugin API, then they should be able to answer any questions in regards to that matter with no problem.
Okay, so let's go to the next area, taxonomy. I know this is really huge as far as us. We've built some very, very, very robust systems, very custom sites for our clients, and taxonomies really played a big role in it. How, why, what should people know?
There's two important things, and basically WordPress first came out as a blogging platform as a replacement for movable type. Matt didn't like movable type, wanted to expand on it. I think that was really cool.
It kills me when I hear people today say, oh, WordPress is just a blog.
Oh, it's insane.
That's a crazy statement and shows a mass amount of...
Here's the dynamic of it, and really, you can look at the database to give you the dynamic of it. You hold all of your data in something that looks like an Excel spreadsheet. So,
what are you on, WP Post?
Yeah, I'm on the post table. Right now, one of the key posts here is post type, as soon as I can find it. You see it? Post type, post type, post type.
Uh-huh.
I'll find it.
There it is.
Okay, post that. Now, realistically, if you look at the way data is stored, you know, everything is just columns of data. Now, a post, which... So, as I was saying, before we were so rudely interrupted by our systems, post title, post content, effectively these are just buckets or containers where a title and content can be stored, as well as dates. Now, believe it or not, your menu items in WordPress are stored as post type menu. Now, I don't see any on the first page. Even your images that you upload, your JPEG images or everything else are stored in these buckets. Now, you don't actually have to have posts. You could have movies, and movies can have movie title, and you can register as many custom fields as you want, which is where custom taxonomies come in. So
you're talking about like page template or post templates, right?
The post templates is the way it's displayed. From the way that it's stored, you can create it. So in our example, we have automated. Yeah, a post doesn't have to be a blog at all.
A post could be a newly released record.
Right.
A good record like yeah. That exists.
No. Yeah, no, I know what you're saying.
A post could be an event.
Album, an event, yeah.
A post could be a new car.
Thing. And in ours, we use it for this, automail setup. If you remember, we have the automailers that go out. We have these automailers that go out that just have title and then, for example, your website is ready mailer.
Okay, so let's stop for just a second. Let's look at our system. What you're looking at right now is the CI CMS, which is the CI Web Group content management system. Effectively, like I said earlier, we use approximately 20% of WordPress core. The rest of it, completely custom. The great part is the way the system is built is we have dozens of our own plugins. I shouldn't say more than dozens, hundreds of our own plugins. Our content management system has been enhanced, I'd say tenfold,
yes.
If not more than that, versus the basic install. So can you go to the basic install of WordPress, and let's look at the difference between, this is WordPress, and you can always tell if the site is WordPress, it's WordPress, it's WordPress. You can go in and easily put it /WP-admin. So this is a basic install of WordPress. You have pages, posts, add categories, post tags, metadata, and so forth. Very, very similar. Now, let's actually go look at pages and say add new. One of the things that we noticed, and this is, I guess, one of the biggest differences in the way that we think. Our executive team has over 15 years in IT, project management, ERP, Enterprise Resource Planning Systems, as well as content management systems, as well as operations and logistics. So we tend to be big, big, big nerds, right? Well, in order for us to run a very tightly ran ship, we listen for things that people want to do and wish they could do with their website. And every time we hear the same request twice, we build it, right?
Yep.
So the cool part is we've been developing on the within the WordPress framework, we have been developing our own content management system, CICMS, for almost 6 years now, yes?
Yep.
So we use the logic of WordPress, and we program the way that it thinks,
yeah.
But we build our own. People are so confused. They think WordPress is a website.
Or they think WordPress is, that's for bloggers.
Yeah.
And the truth is, you know, realistically, it is by default a publishing system. But now what you publish
could be... WordPress is a thought process.
Yeah, it is a thought process. And to try to reinvent thousands of functions that have been perfected by hundreds and hundreds of people would just be stupid. Why would I want to rewrite this beautiful place for our people?
What's the big editor?
Yeah. Why would I rewrite that? Why would I redo the same function? Why would I redo the ability, even the littlest, tiniest things, like when you click edit and that slides down, why would I redo some of those things?
Well, and you see companies, we see them on the sales side, constantly actually going and working with developers and asking them to build things from scratch. I don't know who in their right mind, why they would ever give that advice.
You
want to pay more. You're totally interested in burning your cash in your backyard. I don't know what it is. I mean, it's ridiculous to you and I, but these are big conversations. We have lengthy conversations with people trying to convince them why they should use the framework of the 300,000 programmers who have been developing for 15 years on this application, whatever it is.
Yeah, I still have my publish and post status, you know, why WordPress? I haven't jumped off a bridge yet when somebody asked it, but, you know, it's getting there. The standing on the shoulders of the giants, I should pretty much sum it up, but unfortunately you have to break it down. Like, people want, and I don't know if it's their way of thinking. I don't know if it is they have $2 million in the bank and that's what they budgeted for it, you know. So I don't know what it is that makes them want to redo everything.
It's like this. If I say, Chris, I'm going to race you to China,
uh-huh.
Okay? And we have two choices. A, you can start from my house in Castle Hills in Lewisville, Texas. Or B, I'm going to put you on a Learjet that has been flying around the world, and I'll give you a parachute to jump off. Which do you choose?
With a Bloody Mary at 8 a.m.
It's one of those what are you thinking kind of statements. However, that's not fair because this is kind of like eating an elephant, so we have to go one bite at a time, right?
Yeah.
So
yep.
This is the basic WYSIWYG editor for WordPress. Now let's flip back over to our, let's go to edit page or add new page on our CMS.
Right.
And pages add new. So, yeah, we're good. All right, so some of the things that we've done is try to prevent clients from calling us. No, I shouldn't say that. That's not very nice. So some of the things that we've done, let's go ahead and scroll down. We have a ton of SEO settings so that we can actually optimize content. Now, our short code generator, we're going to do this very quick, and we're recording, and it's kind of a trade thing. So we have built and continue to build tons and tons and tons of different short codes, which essentially what that means is normally you have to call a programmer and say, I want you to build me a 3-column table that has a heading title and 5 list items and so forth, and you have to get a programmer to do it. Well, we got tired of getting those phone calls. It's not a very profitable business to be in if you get those phone calls. So we actually built a short code generator that allows any random user to do that. Now, page layout configuration, if you want to make the page full width, left column, right column, scroll up a little bit, 2 columns, 1 column, you have the ability to by page to redo the entire page and make it look like what you want it to look like instead of having to call somebody. Because WordPress normally it's
usually you have a template. It's a cookie.
It's all templates.
It's all cookie cutter.
Yeah, total cookie cutter. So you have to have a left sidebar or a right sidebar, and it looks the same on every page throughout the entire website. So the other thing is most WordPresses, you have your couple sidebars. Well, we've got it to where you can build unlimited sidebars. So for conversions and web design standpoint, let's say I write an article that's talking about me speaking. Well, on that speaking page, I may want to have a call to action on a sidebar that is book Jennifer to speak at your next event. And on a different blog post, I'm talking about websites. I may want to have a call to action that's a free website consultation. And on a different one, it's SEO, so having mass amounts of sidebars. Different ways to display galleries and images and so forth without having to install a bunch of plugins that slow your site down. So that's the post gallery areas. And then, of course, image effects. I want it to be in a light box. I want it to have a shadow. I want it to have a shadow and a light box. I want it to have a border and so forth. So all the different image effects and settings and so forth. So I'm not going to go too far into this. Actually, let's look over in the social options. So on the right-hand side, one of the things that we've done is we've allowed people to be able to actually integrate their social media on their own. So a lot of times these WordPresses, you're using third-party APIs and plugins. The problem with that is your web page, the more plugins that you start to add, one, it slows your site down. Two, there's obviously security issues.
And as we saw with the WordPress API and 200 new things within one release, you know that these APIs between thousands of social networks change just as quickly.
Exactly. So if you're on a hosting plan and you can't, or you don't have a maintenance team, someone that's maintaining all those upgrades and API modifications and so forth, you're in a whole different ballgame. So anyway, just to kind of give you an idea from a search engine optimization status as well as from a social media marketing status as well as from a design, we blow the WordPress out of the water. So it's great because we have all the benefits of WordPress. When upgrades come out, we get to go through those updates, figure out which portions of it are relevant. We get to upgrade those, but we own our own plugins. We own our own widgets. We own our own sidebars. We own our own content management system. Yes.
This might sound like a lot, but the beautiful part about this is ignorance is bliss, and if you want to hide any one of these widgetized boxes, and when I say widgetized, I mean they're completely dynamic. If you want published not to be there, guess what? You can move it down. So these widgetized pieces of things that we've enhanced it with, I mean, if you don't want to see it, it's too much, you just uncheck it, doesn't show up, you're done.
All right, so we talked about one of the layers being let's pretend we're building a sandwich and we'll wrap this thing up. One of the layers was the database. So let's look at the database in a model view control so that we can look at it from a planning standpoint.
Sure, let's pull it up here.
Okay, so this is the database. Now we're going to look at it in a different view, which allows us for planning. What is the one that looks like?
That's actually something we didn't cover, which is this.
Okay. So we talked about different ways that people can program and so forth. This is Vim, yes?
Yes, this is a different idea. Yeah.
So explain each one of the layers.
Well, right here we have the view layer, which specifies. Now, all a website is a box inside of a box inside of a box. Each one of those can be styled as such. Like this box has a width of 940 pixels. It's the footer at the bottom of the page, margin 0 auto, that centers it. Padding top, this gets away from the rest of the content by 20 pixels. Same thing with the bottom. So this is the CSS file right up here is the style sheets. That defines everything. We also have the dynamic style sheets.
Okay, well, wait. So a lot of times when I'm talking to clients, I'll tell them, unfortunately, when you had your website built, they did all inline styling, which means you're forcing Google to look through your junk style sheets before it actually gets to any content. So you definitely don't want to have inline style. You want to make sure that you're in a global style sheet environment, yes?
Yeah, that's completely true.
I'm a nerd.
The other thing is maintainability. I mean, right now, what we do is I believe we might have lost a little bit of a
shell connection.
Yeah. Okay. Right now what we do, and this is really, really cool, and this allows us to have a text resizer as well. We include a text size up here at the at the body level, let me find it.
So he's talking about the text resizer. If you're on our website, what you'll notice is in the right-hand corner of every post or page, we have this little AA text thing. You only have somebody call so many times that says, when I was at my home computer, the text was real big, but when I go to my office, it looks real small.
That resolution, everybody's got a different one.
Can you please fix that? Because my web page is putting out some weird stuff.
Well, what our global style sheet allows us to do, since we don't hard code everything in pixels, we do a percent of a base. So if I want to increase the text size site-wide, you know, and make it as the standard default, I change one number, one integer right here, and it goes site-wide. You know, the part...
Global.
Yeah, global.
That's what global style sheet means, is I use the size one time, and it applies to all body content. But I use a heading size one time, and it applies to all H1 tags.
And inline CSS will break that.
Inline CSS will absolutely break that, so you don't want to do that. But that's what they teach at school right now.
Yeah.
I just got a master's degree in web design.
So this whole window on the left-hand side is all view stuff. On the, let's go to the bottom left window down here. Now this is header.php. This is where all
the brain.
Yeah.
The smart stuff.
This is where now.
But CSS is closed. That's called the presentation view, right?
Right. Correct.
CSS and HTML. Those two things. Are presentation layers, which is the very, very outer layer. A lot of times you can have a beautiful website that is great PSD files or graphics alongside great CSS and HTML, which basically means you have an absolutely gorgeous Lamborghini that has no brain, right?
Absolutely.
So where's the brain?
And the brain is anything in these PHP tags is part of it, but this is still presentation. These are all a bunch of if statements that conditionally select a teal style sheet, a blue style sheet, and I know I'm pointing.
You're totally pointing.
a blue style sheet or, you know, a teal style sheet right here. You know, these are all conditionals that will dynamically generate your site based off of options that you select or
get?
Content management. Get.
Grep.
Grep is a tool that I use for being able to find chunks of code very easily. Now, in this upper right-hand box,
that's where you have your favorite. Our clients, all our clients, say that their favorite word from you is refresh.
Refresh, yes.
Because you grep things to refresh.
Yeah.
Because he fixes things so fast. So the real programmer can access your entire website, every file, all the logic, the database, and everything from this type of controller, for lack of a better term. Vim, PuTTY, and so forth. However, instead of having to go log in to the screen and go to the editor and go to the WYSIWYG and have to do all that. So when our clients are sitting with Chris, they're like, I love it when he says refresh.
So the upper right area is what we call business logic. There's another layer of the
sandwich.
Yeah, the sandwich. And the whole sandwich is actually called the MVC sandwich. MVC, Model View Control, and Google Images, Model View Control, and I'm sure there's one that looks like a sandwich, but basically it shows
you that. None of those look like a sandwich.
Yeah.
This is how websites should be built. You don't just buy a pretty outfit with no brain, because those are only fun for a while.
Right. Sorry.
Sorry.
I'm blushing.
Couldn't help it. Any of those?
Yeah, that's a good one. I kind of like this one. Oh.
Like that?
I've got to be careful with that. See, get model view control and all of a sudden.
See, now we've got to go back to our security. Now we're going to go back to our security.
So basically, this is starting. I'm pointing again. Starting on the left, you have your request. It says, hey, give me www.crogroup.com. And it goes through the controller which accesses, this is the business logic, the controlled area, accesses the model, which is the database architecture. These are preset views in this area. and then it goes to your relational database. In our case, it's MySQL. Returns back to the controller, goes through and returns back with formulated pretty stuff to the view layer, which can be used in the conditional statements that define everything that you see.
What do you think the percentage of people we just lost is?
Everybody.
I'm sorry. We need to find the sandwich. So, all right. I don't want to go too much further. We've covered a lot of information. Part of this, what was important in this session was I wanted you to kind of get an idea of what's involved in building a website. And, you know, the interesting part is, and actually I would get absolutely hammered by one of our designers, is we have not talked about how websites become pretty, which is the front layer. And that is what the majority of users are interested in seeing, which is what is it going to look like? And they're only interested in that very, very last area of the site, which is the pretty pictures on the outside. So that is when you have designers, graphics designers, who use PSV files. Actually, Eric sent me QuickCar recently. Would it be in DreamWorks or downloads or something? I think it would be in our downloads files. So I did open it, yep. Okay, cool. So I want to give you an idea. When you buy a website from a company, a real company, not a person, and you have all of the different people working on your behalf, you're going to have someone who is developing a database, someone who is developing the business logic, someone who is developing the content management system, and another layer of business logic, someone who is developing the presentation layer, the CSS, someone who is developing the global style sheets, HTML, and so forth. And all of that means nothing to a client. They literally are like, what are you doing? You're not doing anything. Because the only thing that they care about is a really pretty picture, which is the graphics designer. No offense to our graphics team. I love them. And, of course, they're the ones that make everything beautiful, and they make the pretty buttons, and they make the great pictures and all of those things. However, it truly is the very last portion of the web design. Yes?
Yep.
All right. So I'm not going to keep you guys too much further. Today's been a great session. I appreciate you coming. Hopefully we gave you some great questions to ask if you're talking to a web designer to kind of get an idea as far as what their knowledge base is, what you should look for when it comes to building and designing your website. Hopefully you also, again, we're reiterating the requirement that your website is maintained and all of the plugins and so forth are maintained as well, and that your website has a brain. So if you go to websitegrader.com and then throw that website in there, and if it grades out less than an 80 and it's been online for a few months, then you are going to want to give us a ring, because that probably means you had a site that was built a long time ago, or was built by somebody who was born a long time ago, or someone who was born recently, and we sent our lovely kids to school for this. So. What is it? Google?
Demonstrating how we actually do everything in divs instead of tables. And since it's APIs on server side, Google can even read and give us credit for Twitter feeds that are being pulled in, which is awesome, especially for Google Trends. Right now, it's Osama bin Laden.
Yes. All right, you guys, thanks again for coming. I appreciate it. Of course, I'm going to see if I can pull Chris out of the dungeon for some more sessions in the very near future. Hopefully, we didn't go over your head or we didn't sound like we were talking Chinese. We tried to break it down into sandwich language, which I think we did okay. If you need help right away, go to ciwebgroup.com, click on the Contact Us thing, definitely get in touch with us, or you can text web to 313131, and one of our specialists will set up some time to get with you. Again, text web to 313131. Gotta love Notepad, huh? Or get registered, come to the next workshop, www.ciworkshops.com. We'd love to see you there, and please don't hesitate to forward this to your friends, your colleagues, your vendors, your strategic partners. They need the same information. It's very important. And if you have any questions or you want us to review your site publicly on one of our next training sessions. We'd be happy to do a review of your site. And trust me, we'll be nice, not too nice, but nice. Then just go to ciwebgroup.com/fusion. There is a form that you can fill out, Fusion, F-U-S-I-O-N. There's a form you can fill out to get your website submitted. We'd be happy to go over your website and do a complete review as far as we can on one of our next sessions. Thanks again for coming. What?
I was
going to
say, the
Pepsi is about that. That's not Pepsi. It's not Ferris. Nike. Kind of Pepsi-ish thing. It's a yin-yang. All right, you guys. Have a great one. We'll talk to you soon. Thanks again. Bye-bye.
Sorry.
Thank you. Please stand by.